Hey there, amazing audience who have joined the Revolving Time today. Get ready to embark on an unforgettable adventure with us. Subscribe now and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together. Cheaters are everywhere. There are many different types of cheaters, and each one has a unique story to tell. Well, my friends, today's story is published by Little 11. Wife wanted an open marriage after betrayal. Finally, she regrets everything, but it was too late. Full story. Well, let's start the story and see how she lost everything for her betrayal. I must warn you that most of this story consists of conversation. If you don't like dialogue, this will not be your cup of tea. I have, however, avoided using a bundle of quotes during the long conversations by prefacing her words with "she said" and mine with "I said." If you are still reading, here we go. My name is Alan. My wife is Tammy. We became friends when we were pursuing the same major in college. We married when we were both 25 years old. We now have similar jobs with competing firms. It is the nature of our chosen occupation to remain in the background as we represent our well-known or even famous clients. Early on, we adopted a policy of never discussing our clients or their current projects lest we find ourselves on opposite sides of the proverbial fence. We each knew which people our spouse represented, but we didn't share any details of current projects or future plans. From the beginning of our marriage, we both wanted a family. We now have a 7-year-old girl, Gloria, and a 5-year-old boy, Dave. We have been very happy, first as a couple, and now as a family. Both of us have stuck to our no-disclosure rule religiously until today when Tammy chose to nudge it more than a little bit. My first clue that this day would be different was when she shook me awake at 5 a.m. We usually get up at 6, but this morning, a full hour earlier than normal, she placed 2 steaming cups of coffee and 2 warm apple fritters on our bedside table. This marked the very first day that we enjoyed breakfast in bed together. I asked her what the occasion was, and I'm sorry to say, she told me. She said, "As you know, Alan, rules are made to be broken. I need to consult with you about a couple of my clients. Please let me say my piece without interruption. When I finish, I encourage you to react verbally to what you've heard me say. Don't hold back. Empty your mind and your heart. That's the whole reason for this conversation. I want and need to know the reaction of both your heart and brain to my words. You have always been there for me and your advice has always been spot on. With that in mind, here I go. Something is happening at work today that I need to discuss with you. I probably should have mentioned it earlier, but I never thought it would get this far. It concerns my most valued client, the only one that I just can't afford to lose. I will keep within our no-discussion policy as much as possible. I will mention no names and I won't compromise the people involved in any way, but I need to tell you enough to get your advice. Only someone that understands our profession can help me with this matter. I'm fairly confident that you have experienced something similar with one or more of your clients. You are the one that I always turn to when I face any difficult situation. So with the above-mentioned stipulations in mind, I beg you to listen to my story and help me find a solution to my dilemma. Update: It started several weeks ago when I saw an appointment on my calendar with a person whose name was familiar to me and probably to most everyone that enjoys his chosen music genre. He scheduled a meeting to discuss getting me to represent him. Just let me say that to do that would put him in direct competition with the person that I'm calling my most valued client. I will resort to using the Greek alphabet and just call that client Alpha. Alpha has 2 associates that are very close to him. I will refer to those associates as Gamma and Delta. It goes without saying that it's not in my best interests to deal with anyone that could endanger my relationship with Alpha, Delta, and Gamma. In fact, if I were to lose them, my whole world would crumble. Having said that, it was too late to cancel the aforementioned meeting, so I just decided to be very careful when talking to this new potential client. In keeping with the Greek alphabet ruse, I will refer to him as Beta. I must admit that I was pleasantly surprised by Beta when he arrived. He was quite a bit older than me. It only took a few minutes for me to learn to appreciate his wealth of experience. It was obvious that he knew his field very well. After all, he's nothing short of a superstar. He started by saying that he had terminated his relationship with his former agent, and he wanted me to assume that role for him. He presented some pretty persuasive arguments as to how he could enhance my status in the industry and improve some important aspects of my life, all with no threat whatsoever to my relationship with Alpha. He called it a win-win situation. During our 60 minutes together, we were able to get farther than I've ever ventured with a new client before. There just seemed to be some immediate simpatico. He even showed me a few new tricks that he guaranteed would improve my relationship with Alpha. Nevertheless, I was somewhat uncomfortable during our meeting. I didn't want others in our office to know that I was talking with an Alpha competitor, or even worse, to have someone that knew Alpha see me with Beta. Beta could see that I was uncomfortable. and he suggested that we continue our meeting over lunch at a restaurant. I informed him that I was participating in a working lunch with some colleagues. Then he suggested that we meet for drinks and business after work. I informed him that my daughter was pitching in a softball game that evening. There was no way I was missing that. Beta was disappointed, but he understood. He left the door open by saying perhaps we could arrange something the next time he was in town. We left it at that. During the ensuing days, I began to very slowly phase in with Alpha the new tricks that Beta had taught me. Alpha didn't seem to detect the changes, but I noticed that the bottom line had improved. That was encouraging, and it made me rethink the possible value of a secret relationship with Beta. The next week, my Tuesday morning began with a phone call from Beta. He suggested lunch at the Hilton, where he was staying. My warning lights began shining and red flags were waving. I countered with an offer to meet at a place near my office. It was called the Watering Hole. It featured a well-stocked bar, some very private booths, and some surprisingly good food. When he rang off, I had a date scheduled with him at the Watering Hole. We made some good progress for the first half hour of our date. He discreetly demonstrated several more tricks. I was gradually becoming more appreciative of the experience that he brought to the table. He was in his 60s, but he didn't look like it or act like it. His knowledge was impressive and his demeanor was infectious. We were discussing how our relationship could be formalized without Alpha becoming aware of it. I insisted that we couldn't let Alpha know or even suspect that I was contemplating becoming Beta's agent. Our discussion ended abruptly when I saw an associate of Alpha walking through the door. I grabbed my purse and carefully slipped out of the booth without a word to Beta. I walked behind the bar and slipped out the side door. I silently prayed that I hadn't been seen. When I was safely in the privacy of my office, I telephoned Beta to let him know why I left so abruptly. He said we needed to quit going to these public places. He said that we needed more privacy. I agreed. As the days passed with me waiting for his next call, I found myself comparing all of my male colleagues to Beta. I agreed with myself that Beta had no equal among them. He was so knowledgeable, so experienced, so eloquent, so debonair, so everything. No one else came close. I should say, no one but Alpha, who remained my most valued client. My next call from Beta was a short one. He just said he wanted me to call him from my personal cell phone as soon as I could do so in a private setting. I begged off from lunch with the girls and called Beta from a bench in the park. He told me that it was time to SHT or get off the pot. He said that he had devised a contract that spelled out in detail how we would work together and soar to heights where the air is rare and exotic adventures abound. He stressed that the relationship we would be embracing was designed to have no impact on my relationship with Alpha. In fact, Alpha would benefit from all the new strategies and tricks that I would be learning from Beta. As for Beta, his universe would be complete the minute I joined forces with him. It was the quintessential flawless agreement. Everyone would benefit. The next step would be for me to carefully consider all of the elements of his proposal. He wanted me to read it page by page and cover to cover. He stressed once again that signing on to represent him would in no way harm my relationship with Alpha. He guaranteed it. He said that enough time had elapsed and I knew him well enough to make a decision. We needed to execute the agreement without further delay. It needed to be done in a place that provided complete privacy. He suggested his hotel room. It would be the perfect place to consummate our agreement. Alan, here is why I'm telling you all of this. I agreed to meet Beta in his room at noon today. I need to hear you say that it's all right to bend the rules of our profession slightly when it benefits everyone. I've never asked you about your relationships with your clients, but now I need to know your thoughts about an agreement like I'm considering. I hope that you will tell me that you have done something like this before and it turned out well. I value your opinion above everything. Am I about to make an unconventional but auspicious career move, or am I about to make an irreversible mistake? I hope that you understand the words that I've spoken and appreciate all of the related undercurrents. It is with hope, but also consternation, that I turn the floor over to you. What sayest thou? Update 1, I said. Since we work in similar, if not identical, fields, I completely understand your dilemma in professional terms. There is always a temptation to take on a client that is in competition with one of your existing clients. While doing so could be profitable, it is very risky and, in my view, also unethical. That's my professional opinion in a nutshell. Having said that, before I can give you an answer to what I perceive to be the question that you're actually asking, I need to talk about words. You have always been better with words than I am. You aced all of your English classes while I just barely passed. So, I'm at a big disadvantage here. I don't know the words to use to describe my innermost feelings about what I just heard you say. I'm convinced that there's more to your words than what enters the ear. I'm not sure of how to describe it. The word duplicity comes to mind. but I'm not sure it fits. You probably remember the discussion in Professor Davison's English class about a word that might fit. As I remember it, the word was polysemy, but I may have that wrong. Along those lines, it appears that I may have had quite a few things wrong about our relationship and our marriage. Perhaps I've been looking through rose-colored glasses, not seeing things as they actually are. Keeping in mind that I may not be answering the question that you are asking, I will just proceed with my conception of your inquiry. Let me start by saying that I perceive your words to be an attempt to turn a trashy, filthy, gutter story into a Greek tragedy. I'll just attempt to play along with that for now. I have a client that is to me what Alpha is to you. In keeping with your Greek alphabet ruse, I will call my client Tau. I would not, and I mean never ever, allow any other client to endanger what I've always thought was my padlock connection to Tau. Tau is on a pedestal that can be reached only by a private ladder that belongs to me unilaterally. If someone else was to violate my ownership of that ladder and climb up to Tau, the ladder, the pedestal, and Tau would come crashing down, never again to be touched by me. As to your question as to whether or not I have ever faced a situation like yours, I can recall at least four occasions when I faced a situation like the one that I think you are describing. Unlike you, I never allowed any of them to grow, much less blossom. I knew in my heart that if I allowed it to grow, every petal on the flower would have to be kept secret from Tau. As more and more flowers appeared, those secrets would be more and more difficult to keep hidden. In short, I chose not to till the ground, let alone plant the seed. It's a little late to advise you to do what I did. Your plant has already grown. If the flower hasn't already appeared, it will soon. Petal by petal, it will grow and grow. Finally, I have indeed noticed some changes in your behavior during the last few weeks. I must admit that they have been good changes and that they pleased me. I thought that you had just decided to be a little more adventurous. Now, I'm not so sure. Maybe you had a teacher. If so, I can only fantasize about what went on in his classroom and wonder how much time you spent there. Then again, maybe you've already told me. Okay, enough with the Greek sea rap. Here's what I think you're saying. You've had a client of mine ask you to represent him. He has been a star in his field and he is older, more experienced, and so on. You swooned for him and fell hard, right on his you-know-what. At some point, you remembered me, Gloria, and Dave. What to do? What to do? How about getting my permission for what you're doing? So, you took your slime, wrapped it in a Greek scroll, and asked me to read it and sign it, thereby giving my approval to your ruse. Well, I will never sign it. That doesn't mean you have to stop your sordid behavior, just that it has a cost that you need to be prepared to pay. Do I have everything about right? She said, after hearing what you've said and what you suspect, I'm reconsidering everything about my relationship with Beta. I think I'll call him this morning. I'll tell him that I have counted the cost and found that a trip to the Hilton today will cost me much more than I can afford. I will recommend burning the contract. Furthermore, I will inform him that he is no longer on my list of potential clients. All ties will be forever severed. I thank my lucky stars that I got up early to prepare breakfast for us. I now know what it means when they say that honesty is the best policy. I said, honesty is indeed the best policy, but it is time restricted. It has to happen before any lasting damage has occurred. Speaking of damage, here's some more Greek for you. I just examined the ladder that I told you about. I discovered that it has a badly broken rung. Once a rung breaks, the whole ladder enters a danger zone. It can never be trusted again. What I'm saying in my own duplicitous way is that you shouldn't make that phone call to Beta this morning. You should instead make the trip to the Hilton at noon. It's what you really want to do and you will never be happy with going back to what used to be. Don't worry about me. I'll be all right. After hearing your words today, I no longer feel the way I used to feel about our life together or our marriage. I don't believe you learned those tricks that you shared with me in a restaurant. I don't believe that today was going to be your first trip to his room. In short, I don't believe you and I don't trust you. Love without trust is worthless. Go do what you have to do. I'm not saying that I won't suffer, because I will. In keeping with your duplicity, so will Gamma and Delta. I'm not certain about things between you and Beta, but I do know something that you need to hear. First, I know that your Beta is Buddy Black. After all, I've been his agent for many years, as you well know. What you don't know is how much his numbers have dropped recently. He's still the revered grandfather of his genre, but that grandfather title is the problem. He hasn't kept up with the ever-changing scene in this digital world. He's still thinking about yesterday's songs and vinyl records while a multitude of new performers that compete with him are thinking about tomorrow's songs and streaming. I used every arrow in my quiver trying to bring him into this brave new world. Nothing worked. It finally got to the point where the only place I could book him was on the casino circuit. He blamed me for his falling numbers and obscure bookings. He severed our relationship saying that he would make me pay. He promised to get even with me. I'll give him credit, he sure kept that promise. He found the only tool, yes, the one and only tool that would allow him to hurt me as much as humanly possible. He found you. Update 2. I dressed for work in silence except for some sobs coming from the bedroom. Without a word, I descended the stairs and opened the hall closet. I grabbed the suitcase that I keep packed for when I travel. As I walked to my car, I was dialing the reservations number for my favorite hotel chain. It's not the Hilton. After reserving a room for a week, I made another call. I had never in my wildest dreams thought I would ever be securing the services of a divorce attorney, but it happened today. The first appointment available was 3 weeks hence, but a delay is to be expected when you're retaining the best in the field. I was a little late reporting for work. As the day progressed, my attention was divided between the tasks at hand and in visualizing what Tammy was doing at the Hilton. I knew I shouldn't care, but I did. My phone was on, but there were no calls from her. Guess that told me what I needed to know. When my workday was over, I drove to my hotel. As I was getting my stuff out of the car, Tammy drove up beside me. She lowered her window and said, "Don't be ridiculous, Alan. Come home. We need to talk. We talked all we needed to yesterday, Tammy. From now on, it will be your attorney talking to mine." That's bull C rap, honey. I didn't take the trip. I made the call instead. I've severed all connections to Buddy. No contract, no relationship, no anything. Come home with me. Let's start rebuilding what I destroyed. We have a good foundation to build on. I was careful not to bring the whole building down. My love for you was never destroyed. I had that conversation with you yesterday to avoid as much destruction as possible. It worked. I chose you, not Buddy. I don't see it that way, Tammy. I think there has been plenty of damage. I don't think the wreckage you caused is repairable. But it definitely is fixable, honey. If you won't do it for me, do it for Gloria and Dave. I'm prepared to make any and all concessions necessary to preserve our family. Come home with me, Alan. Even if I thought that was a good idea, I already have a room reserved for a week. I'll pay for damn room, Alan. Come home with me. We need to talk. Let's get some counseling. At least do that much for me and your children. Her words got me thinking. I hear a lot about couples staying together for the kids, but is that a good idea? If the parents are unhappy and no longer in love, can they even begin to do a good job of raising children? There's a big difference between a family of convenience and a loving family. Knowing that, perhaps a counselor would be able to help. I said, "Tammy, if a counselor of my choice thinks we can survive what's happened and recommends that I come home, I will. That's the best that I can offer. Make the appointment, honey. I'll be there with bells on my toes. I want you home." I did make the appointment, and we both told our stories. The one thing that I noticed was that if Tammy had ever thought that Buddy just used her to get even with me, she never revealed those feelings. To the surprise of Tammy and even me, the counselor suggested that I keep the hotel room. She said we needed to experience life without each other. We needed to see what a divorce would really be like. To that end, she drew up what she called an interim agreement. It covered custody, visitation, keeping the house functioning, paying the bills, and such. Living under the agreement would mean living life as near as possible to an actual divorce. There would be no conversation or interaction between the two of us except as allowed by the agreement. The counselor stressed that the agreement was just that, an agreement. It was completely voluntary and had no legal standing. Its purpose was to let us taste divorce before we took that plunge. At any time, either one of us could terminate the agreement and file for a real divorce. I'm not sure that either of us was happy with it, but we signed the papers. After signing, I canceled my appointment with the divorce attorney. Update 3. We began living strictly by the agreement. She had the house. I left the hotel and leased an apartment. The agreement specified that the kids could stay with me on one of the 2 weekend days. I was also able to spend 2 evenings with them during the week as long as I had them back to Tammy well before bedtime. One thing that I didn't expect was when Tammy went ahead and became Buddy's agent. That disappointed me, but it was not a violation of the agreement. At least they made no effort to get married or rekindle their affair. Unlike when it all started, it appeared to be just a business arrangement between them. To her credit, Tammy pulled a pretty good trick out of her hat. She decided to go big in an attempt to put Buddy's career back on track. She let it all hang out and put all of her eggs in his basket. She scheduled a big Buddy Black comeback tour. The first comeback concert would be televised on a major network. I kept one eye on what she was doing, but I had my own fish to fry. Everything just moved along smoothly until the day that Tammy called me with fire in her voice. "Do you hate me and Buddy this much?" she screamed. I was at a loss for words. Finally, I asked her what brought that on. She shouted, "Like you don't know. I see your fingerprints all over this big concert called a new Woodstock. It just happens to be on the same night as Buddy's tour opening concert. What did it cost you to get a show like that together and air it on a competing network in the same time slot as ours? You took your time, but you're finally getting your revenge on Buddy and me. When did you become such a bast? It was my turn to yell. I shouted that I didn't know about any such concert, but I was kicking myself for not thinking of it. I assured her that I had nothing to do with it in any way. I pointed out that no client of mine had been signed to appear on such a show. I suggested that she should get her facts straight. I asked her if she had done any investigation into the concert before she made this call, or did she just assume that I was behind it? She just dropped the connection. I did some investigating on my own and traced it to another agent that represented several big competitors in Buddy's genre. That agent would profit majorly by hindering the comeback tour. I never liked the guy. In fact, I couldn't stand him and Tammy knew it. I called to set her straight. When she answered the phone, her first words were, "I apologize. I'm just so upset. That Woodstock thing will ruin our comeback tour. I have all of my assets tied up in it. Is this revolting development some kind of karma for what Buddy and I did to you?" I told her I didn't put much stock in karma. I said she should just focus on doing the best show possible and hope that the new fans were not all that interested in a new Woodstock. I told her that while I didn't have any clients in the genre anymore, I would give her a list of my clients that would be available on the night of the concert. She could pick any of them that she wanted and I would let them appear on Buddy's big gig at no charge. As I said, I didn't like the agent that they were up against. I'd had more than one run-in with him. Update 4. I heard tears in her voice as she thanked me for the offer. Having said that, she never responded when I sent her the list. She went it alone. It turned out that there were many more people interested in a new Woodstock than in a Buddy Black comeback. Buddy's TV show ratings were dismal, but even worse, the comeback tour had to be canceled halfway through the schedule. Ticket sales had been extremely disappointing. Tammy had included many of her other clients in the comeback effort. They began leaving her agency. I grieved at her failure and felt no elation when Buddy announced that he was retiring to California. After all, I was not completely heartless. I remembered good times with both of them. As the agreement gradually became our lives, we slowly drifted apart. I wasn't very happy with the drift, but as they say, it is what it is. Everything was going as well as could be expected until the day that Tammy was terminated by her agency. She tried all of the other agencies in the area, but her name was mud because of the comeback fiasco. She had depleted her assets funding the comeback tour, and now she had no salary. She was no longer able to pay her share of the mortgage or utilities. Out of necessity, we agreed to violate our interim agreement slightly. I was able to sublet my apartment at a slight profit and move into the basement recreation room at what now, per the agreement, was Tammy's house. I slept on the somewhat lumpy sofa. Almost every night when I headed to the basement, Tammy told me that I was welcome to share her bed. After many nights of this harassment, I reluctantly relented. Just like that, we were violating another clause of our agreement. I, being a rather fitful sleeper, accidentally touched or grabbed some forbidden as of Tammy's anatomy quite regularly. I was eating my meals with the family, taking everyone out to restaurants, watching TV movies with Tammy, playing games with the kids, and attending sporting events. It was just like we did back before Buddy came on the scene. Page by page, we were shredding our agreement. One cold night, Tammy asked me to build a fire in the fireplace. She handed me a stack of paper saying, "Why don't you use these to start it?" You guessed right, it was the pages of our interim agreement. Things were returning to normal until Tammy started complaining of headaches. If they had only happened when we were in bed, I would have been suspicious. That wasn't the case. She seemed to be having a constant headache. I had been on her case to see a doctor for weeks. She finally did. They ran every test in the book and then some. The news was not good. She was diagnosed with inoperable cancer of the brain. My world was shattered. I had a long discussion with her doctor. He said that her cancer had probably been there for at least a year or two before the headaches began. He asked me if I had noticed her forgetting things or making bad decisions. Bad decisions. My God. I certainly had. Did that explain everything? Tammy kept saying that it was her karma, but I knew better. Knowing that she had cancer shouldn't have made me feel better, but it kind of did. I finally understood everything. It wasn't me. It wasn't her. It wasn't Buddy. It was cancer. They said we probably had one good year left. After that, not so good. The headaches would get worse. She would begin having seizures. There could be incontinence, blackouts, nausea, and vomiting. Near the end, she would lose her eyesight and possibly her hearing too. Soon after that, she would lose her life. Armed with medication to ease her pain, we began to do the things we had always planned to do as a family, plus some things we hadn't even dreamed of doing. I let my understudy take over my day-to-day tasks. I remained available by phone to handle things that demanded my personal attention. Otherwise, all of our time was spent on family adventures. We visited national and regional parks. We took in concerts. We visited the Grand Ole Opry, Disneyland, Disney World, and the Smithsonian, to name a few. We flew to Alaska and Hawaii. We packed everything possible into one very good year. Tammy had a prescription for some strong pain medication which she took only when the headaches got unbearable. I noticed that she was squirreling away some of her medication every day. She placed it in a bottle that she kept in her bottom dresser drawer. She thought it was a secret. She didn't know that I had installed multiple cameras in the house so I could observe her condition 24 hours. I could see the output from the cameras on my phone. I finally told her that I knew what she was doing and I understood why she was doing it. Many times she had said that she didn't want to be a burden on me and she didn't want her children to see her suffering near the end. Can you imagine what seeing me like that would do to them, Alan? To see me having seizures, blackouts, and going blind. They would have nightmares for the rest of their lives. She was right, of course, but I told her that I wanted her with me as long as possible. I said, when it gets really bad, we can take you someplace where they can make you as comfortable as possible. I will help you through it. I will stay by your side and hold your hand. She said, I've done my research, Alan, and I know how many pills I have to take. Please don't interfere. Don't deny me this chance to retain my dignity. I have always hated the dark. I can't imagine being in constant darkness in a hospital or nursing home. It would be worse than dying. Please let me do what I have to do. Please grant me this. Let me leave while I still know what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. I will wait as long as possible. But don't make me wait until I don't have the physical or mental strength to do it. It was the following week that I told Tammy about my promise to make a basketball goal for Dave. I was heading to a big box store to get some parts. She said, you're such a wonderful dad. Our kids are so lucky to have you. You're also the world's best husband. So much more than I deserve. After a little more conversation, she said, sorry, honey. I took a pain pill and I can't keep my eyes open. Come see me when you get back. With that, she closed her eyes. We kissed before I left to do my shopping. Little did I know that we'd just had our last conversation and our last kiss ever. Update 5. When I got home, I yelled, I'm back, honey. I listened for her response as I carried my sack of parts to my workbench. When I didn't hear her voice, I checked my phone. She was still sleeping. I gathered the parts that I needed and took them out to the driveway and started working. I spent about an hour on the project and made a pretty good start. Dave would be impressed. I decided to take a break. I grabbed two bottles of tea and headed to the bedroom. Tammy was laying there in a half-sitting position with several pillows behind her back. Her eyes were closed and she looked peaceful, but I knew at once that something was wrong. I don't know how I knew, I just did. There were two notes propped against her bedside lamp. I knew what they were. I reached for the one with my name on it. I could see her tears still damp on the paper. There were only a few words there, but reading them was the most difficult thing I'd ever done. I was constantly wiping tears and it took me an inordinate amount of time to finish reading her words. My tears mingled with hers on that precious piece of paper. I kissed her cheek and stroked her hair. It was over. The love of my life was gone forever. Everyone gathered at our house. We all made it through those horrible hours despite the huge hole in every heart. How do we go on? We do it for each other. We do it for a perfect mom. We do it for a loving daughter, daughter-in-law. We do it for a perfect wife that suffered a brain tumor that led to some irrational behavior that turned her perfection into imperfection. As soon as I knew about the cancer, I understood why she did those things, but she continued to hate herself. She refused to blame cancer for her actions. She believed that it was the other way around. She thought her betrayal caused her cancer. She said it was her karma. Her note to David and Gloria was mostly an apology. She apologized for not being able to watch them grow up and do all of the things that mean so much. She mentioned graduating from high school, moving into a college dorm, graduating from college, and going forth to improve the world. She mentioned missing their weddings and not being there when her grandchildren were born. It was a long letter and toward the end, she told them that it was all her fault. She told them that their father would tell them about what happened and about karma when they were old enough to understand it all. She ended by telling them that she would be with them every day and watch over them every night. I found myself hoping that the kids would forget to ask me about what happened and about karma. I decided to lock the note that she wrote to me in the drawer of our bedside table. I promised myself that I would read it every night. In case you're wondering what she said in her note to me, here it is. Alan, honey, I apologize for being a coward. I took the easy way out. I made some very bad decisions, did some unforgivable things, and betrayed the best husband in this world. A man who was also the most affectionate, thoughtful, compassionate, and kind-hearted person that I've ever met. One of the last things I remember telling you was what a good father you have been and will continue to be. I leave our children in your care with complete confidence that they will be cherished with a mammoth amount of love. Speaking of the kids, there's a picture for each of them in my bottom dresser door. There's also one for you. The picture shows me looking down and smiling. Please hang one at the foot of Gloria's bed and one at the foot of David's bed. It will look like I'm watching over them. I promised them that I would do that. I hope you will also hang one at the foot of our bed. The last thing I will ask is that you burn this note. It's just not adequate to the task of thanking you for all the good times. There were so many firsts for us, so many glorious days, and so many nights of rapture. Burn this note and move on. Do it for your own sake and the sake of the children. Do it for me. This is my last apology. I'm sorry for trashing everything. I didn't appreciate what I had nearly as much as I should have. I turned my back on you with an undeserved betrayal. I doubt that you can ever forget that. So take any undeserved love that you still have for me and give it to our children. I hope David turns out to be just like you, and I hope Gloria turns out to be nothing like me. Please do one last thing for me. Stop blaming the cancer. The fault is all mine. What happened to us was due to my weakness. It was something I couldn't resist or cast away. I will always cherish this last year together as a family. I realize that you rekindled your love for me during that time, and it was a fantastic year for our children. This year changed lots of things, but not everything. You will soon forget our fantastic year and remember how you felt before you found out about my cancer. You must learn to hate me. It will help you deal with the real me. Embrace that hate. It will help you survive. My behavior caused the cancer, not the other way around. It was and still is my karma. Final update. I must admit that her note had me very confused. What was that message at the end all about? What was she trying to tell me? One other thing that I couldn't help but notice, she never professed her love for me in her note. There was not even one "I love you" to be found. After everyone left and it was time to go to bed, I debated whether or not to sleep in the bed that she died in just a few hours ago. I chose to sleep in the den, but I decided to clean our bedroom and make the bed. When I was removing the old sheets, I noticed a folded up newspaper. Even in this digital age, Tammy loved to read the paper and had it delivered to the house every day. It was today's paper. It was the last one she would ever read. I decided to put it with her note. When I picked it up, I noticed that the page she had been reading announced the death of Buddy Black. It stated that his death had been ruled a suicide. It speculated that he was never able to recover mentally or financially from the failure of his comeback tour. Needless to say, I was shocked. The page was stained with her tears. My mind formed an unanswerable question. Had she executed a suicide pact with him? I found her phone beneath the newspaper. I picked it up. I was surprised to see that it was unlocked. She had always kept it locked, able to be unlocked only by her fingerprint. Why had she changed that? When I tapped the screen, her messages were displayed. It seems like she had purposely set it up that way. She wanted me to read them, so I did. The words I read were like a dagger stabbing into my heart. The first message was sent after that first day when Buddy showed up at her office. She was telling him that she had never before been kissed with such ardor. With each message, the sexual content escalated. They revealed devastating details about the multitude of times when she had enjoyed intercourse with him. She often compared him to me. He always won. I was always second best. With him it was ecstasy. With me, it was just her perceived duty. She even texted with him hundreds of times during our special year of family adventures. Those messages mentioned nothing about how much she was enjoying the things that we were doing together as a family, but they went on and on about how much she missed him and loved him. I read such messages for hours without coming close to reading them all. I was surprised that her phone memory, coupled with her share of the digital cloud, could store so many messages. I was beyond being devastated. I was destroyed. Yes, she had spent that last year with me, but her heart had remained with him. She stayed only so she could spend her last days with her children. I was there only to serve as her caregiver. They say there's a thin line between love and hate. I can attest to that. As much as I'm hurting and hating, however, I will still strive to fulfill most of her last wishes. I will hang her picture at the foot of Gloria's bed. I will hang her picture at the foot of Dave's bed. Instead of locking her note in the drawer of our bedside table like I promised myself, I will submit to her request and burn it. I will not, however, hang her picture at the foot of my bed as she requested. I will burn it along with her note. Here's my pledge to Tammy. I will try my very best to be a good father to our children. They will never hear me disparage their mother. My pledge to myself, I will always remember that thin line between love and hate. I love Tammy as much as one human can love another. But now, because of what I've learned, I have crossed to the hate side of that line. That thin line has become very thick. So thick that it would be nothing short of impossible for me to ever cross back. The end. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. So take care of yourself and see you soon with another story.